professor in the Department of Ecology and Evolutionary Biology at Princeton University. She received her bachelor's degree in 1960 from Edinburgh University in Scotland, and her PhD from Uppsala University in Sweden in 1985. She and her husband Peter Grant, who's also visiting the audience today, have studied the adaptive radiation of Darwin's finches in the Galapagos Islands for more than 40 years. Dr. Grant's work involves investigating the interaction of genetics, ecology, and behavior to understand diversity of individuals and the process of speciation. Her numerous publications include articles in both Science and Nature, as well as 5 books. Dr. Grant has received many awards, often with Dr. Peter Grant, for her contributions to biology, including a Balzan Prize in Population Biology, the Royal Society Darwin Medal, the Linnaean Society Darwin Wallace Medal, and a Kyoto Prize in Basic Sciences. We are very honored to have her here today. Please join me in giving a warm welcome to Dr. Rosemary Grant.
Going to switch gears. So my title is One Health, Lessons from a Natural Ecosystem. And I'm going to begin with this closing sentence from Charles Darwin's On the Origin of Species. It's both poetic and, in his day, optimistic. He wrote, "There is grandeur in this view of life, with its several powers having been originally breathed into a few forms or into one. And that whilst this planet has gone cycling on according to the fixed law of gravity, from so simple a beginning, endless forms, most beautiful, endless wonderful, have been and are being evolved." And it is true that when we go hiking in the alpine meadows, or we dive beneath the surface of the sea, we're absolutely amazed at the wonder of biodiversity. And then, if we take hone in on just one species, or one group of species, for example, the anolis lizards on the Caribbean, studied by Jonathan Lissos, we see that for every one of these lizards you see here, there are 7 more, all in the Caribbean, all flashing their independent species signature on their juniors. Or we can go to the cichlid fishes, and this is just in Malawi, Lake Malawi, and this is just one small fraction of the diversity of these fishes. But we also can think more deeply and consider that life on this earth is extremely fragile. All our life, all the biodiversity, of course, in this thin film covering planet Earth, in just the crust, the lithosphere, and the lower levels of the atmosphere. So it is not too surprising that in the past this has been blown away, almost blown away, several times. For example, the most severe one that we know about in the past was the Permian-Triassic mass extinction, which occurred 252 million years ago. 96% of all marine species are thought to have gone extinct at this time, as well as 70% of all terrestrial vertebrates. And there are several reasons that have been suggested for this. One was the impact from the meteorite, and this has been told by shot grains of quartz in Australia and Antarctica. There was possibly volcanism from the Siberian tracks, or as Andrew Knoll showed, the sudden release of methane from an anoxic and acidic ocean. Suggested this by using carbon isotope ratio found in the rocks. This caused sea level changes and a shift in ocean circulation. All these things could have occurred simultaneously or closely sequentially, but they were obviously devastating. Today, fragmentation of the environment and rate of species extinction is largely human-induced. The leading threat, as we've heard today, being insatiable consumption and exploitation by industrialized nations. These include logging, agriculture, mining, fossil fuels, and as we heard yesterday from in Brazil, the building of dams. Now, not all this biodiversity occurs not spread out throughout the whole of the world, but it is often concentrated in several patches. And I probably know Ecuador best. And in Ecuador, although it is a tiny country, only occupying 0.2% of the world's surface, yet it has more species per square mile than any other country in the world. Many are endemic. Holds 14 indigenous nationalities, and of course part of this is due to the diversity of habitat. This is a photograph of the Paramos of high in the Andes, but Ecuador stretches down through the cloud forest and right down into the tropical rainforest. And then out again to the Galapagos Islands, which has many endemic species. Now, the highest diversity within all this is in the Yasuni National Park. This has the highest diversity of endemic reptiles, amphibians, insects, birds, and mammals than anywhere else in South America, and possibly even the world. And yet, underlying all this is oil. Satellite data shows that Ecuador's loss of the rainforest is 4% per year. Globally, rainforest loss is 86,000 hectares per day. This is an area equivalent to New York City, or we can think of it in another way, there are 2 US football fields per second disappearing per second. So the question is, how do we preserve a healthy ecosystem on which all life depends? Can we gain any lessons at all from looking very closely at a dynamic, fragmented natural system? And I think we can. The one that I'm going to choose, of course, having done so much work on the Galapagos Islands, is the Galapagos Islands. The Galapagos Islands are fragmented. They occur 6,000 kilometers off the coast of Ecuador. They're a group of islands, most of which are uninhabited, and it's close to being as pristine as you could get probably anywhere in the world. 4 of them are inhabited. And they are dynamic. They're probably one of the most dynamic places on Earth. There has been recurrent volcanism from its inception about 10 million years ago or more to the present day. Glacial cycles in the last have been constantly occurring, and in the last million years there have been 10 glacial cycles, which lower and raise the sea level by as much as 125 meters and more. And then for the last 7,000 years or so, it has been buffeted by the El Nino Southern Oscillation phenomenon, which brings rainfall, extended rainfall for some years, and then in La Nina conditions, droughts which can last for 2 to 3 years. So just to show you, to give you some idea of the effect that these glacial cycles have, this is the Galapagos on the present day, and of course we are in an interglacial. And then as the water becomes locked up in the glaciers, in the glacial poles, then the sea level falls, and 2,000 years ago it fell approximately 125 meters. When this happens, the islands expand, of course, and they converge. Then, as water is released from the polar ice caps during the interglacials, the islands diminish until only but the very tops of the volcanoes keep above the surface of the ocean. So the whole stage on which this is played is a moving stage. It is extremely dynamic for these 3 reasons: volcanism, sea level rises and falls, and the El Nino oscillation phenomenon. last 1 to 2 million years in this landscape, Darwin's finches have evolved. So 40 species have evolved from a common ancestor. Today they occupy very different ecological niches, and they're very different in size, and particularly in the beak and size shape, which is a tool for picking up their food. So what I'm going to introduce you now is to take you to Daphne Island, an island in the Galapagos. And although we have studied finches on all the islands in the Galapagos, we have concentrated on two. One of them is Daphne, the other is the island of Kenepesa. But today I will just concentrate on populations on these two islands. So the question that I'm going to ask is, how do populations survive severe natural environmental fluctuations? How is genetic and phenotypic variation maintained during these fluctuations? We have also had one of the most exciting things that has happened in our work, which is the origin of a new lineage, which we followed completely from its inception up through 6 generations. And then I'm going to bring all this together and say, what are the lessons gained from this natural system that we can use today to help to save the situation that we are in? So first of all, these extreme interannual fluctuations allow us to measure and to track changes through time. In El Niños, we've heard about El Niños. In El Niños in the Galapagos Islands, what happens is that the trade winds in an El Niño condition, the trade winds stop and fail, the sea surface temperature across the equator heats up, and this brings large amounts of rainfall to the Galapagos Islands. And so we can get rain continuously, torrential rain continuously, several months at a time. The opposite occurs in La Niña conditions, when the trade winds continue, they don't fail, then Humboldt Current comes, washes the Galapagos Island, and a drought occurs. It's actually a drought on the land, but it's abundance in the sea, because of so much upwellings of cold water in the sea, which is just bountiful for the fish and the seabirds thrive at this time. But when we first arrived in 1973 on Daphne, there were large numbers of two populations. One is the tortoise, the ground fish, here, this little bird up here, the medium ground fish, and the other one is Scandens up here. Tortoise feeds on seeds on the ground. Scandens is popular name is the cactus fish, and it concentrates on nectar and pollen in the breeding season, in the season, or when the hunter is flowering, and then in the dry season, it is able to break with its long beak, break open the fruits, and consume the seeds. So it is a cactus specialist, whereas tortoise is much more of a generous feeding on seeds. Scandens picking the flowers. And the tortoise is extremely variable, the population is very variable in beak size. And one of the first things we did or found when we first arrived on the island is that we caught birds, banded them, measured them, observed what they were feeding, and we found that the birds with the small beaks were feeding on small soft seeds. Those birds that had the larger beaks were able to crack the large hard seeds, particularly tribulus seeds and the large hard Opuntia seeds, whereas the birds with medium-sized beaks were able to eat the small and the medium-sized seeds, but were unable to eat the large seeds. So the bill size was very much associated with the foods that they were taking. And over the 40 years period that we have examined these birds, we've seen enormous fluctuations of beak depth. We started out here in 1973. These tram lines are the 95% confidence limit. And if there had been no change at all, we would just see the dots over the years occurring within these tram lines. But as you see, see the average peak size is going right up here, it's come down again, and then come up once again. And today we have birds that are very different in body size and peak size than our stalking birds. Whereas in Scandinavians, beak depth has more or less remained the same. So we knew that when we first arrived that if we were to track the changes that had occurred, and if we were to find evolution by natural selection, we must show, first of all, that there must be heritable variation in our trait of interest, which was our beak dimensions and our body size. And as a result of some environmental perturbation, there has to be differential survival. And in the next generation, the offspring of the survivors must resemble their parents in the trait of interest. It is any evolution by natural selection. If there was no heritable variation, then this would be just solely due to environmental conditions, and we would be back to the starting place each time. So the first thing we did was to look at to see if there was any heritability. And so we measured the parents and the offspring when they grew up and were adults, and we progressed the offspring on the different parents, and we found that the heritability of beak depth in porters was extremely high, 0.72. If there had been no heritability, this would have been zero. If there had been complete heritability and no environmental influence, it would be one. But 0.72 is extremely high, and it's about the heritability that you get with human height size. In Scandinavians, there was heritability for beak length, again very high at 0.81. Now, we didn't have to wait too long before we got our first environmental perturbation. And this occurred in 1977, when we got an absolutely complete drought. And 80% of the birds over that year died. Oops, sorry. So this is what the island looked like normally in one patch during a normal wet season, and this is what it looked like in 1977. There was just rocks. The whole thing was just more or less a pile of rocks with a few plenty of bushes elsewhere on the island and some birstroot trees with no leaves on it at all. But the birds were left to forage in these rocks for the seeds. So what happened is that very soon the few small soft seeds disappeared, and then all that was left were these large, hard, trivial seeds up here, which only the largest of the birds would crack. So although all birds were dying, the smaller birds were dying faster. And so gradually over the year, the average beak size of porters became larger and larger, until by the time we got to January 1979, the average size, were very few birds left in the population, but the average beak size was much larger. So this constitutes a natural selection event. And because of the high heritability, we got the offspring when these birds began to breed again, when the rains came back, the birds began to breed again, then the offspring were also large like their parents. So here's the average offspring in the next generation, and this is an evolutionary response to a natural selection event. And this is at this point here, where we get the average beak size has increased over our starting point. So our next environmental perturbation occurred here in 1983. And here we had an El Nino year. This is a rainfall graph, and we had the most severe El Nino year from coral core that had occurred in the last 400 years. It rained almost every day for 8 months. The birds bred once a month for eight months. They bred 8 times. Now, what also happened, the island was completely transformed. it was transformed from a large hard seed producer to a small soft seed producer. And I'll just go through the pictures just to show you this. So, this is what the island looks like normally. The first rain, we start to get plants growing up in between the rocks. These plants, so mostly looks like an alpine meadow. And these plants are mostly the tribulus plants, which produce the large hard seeds that made the difference between the survival and non-survival in 1977. But in this El Niño, in this El Niño year, more rain fell, the grasses grew up and completely smothered the tribulus plants, and then we got more rainfall, more plants grew up, vines appeared, the vines started to cover the cactus bushes and the trees, and even after, in the following year, after the El Niño year had started, everything was free with this dead vegetation. And our project data show that the islands which produced the large hard seeds before, had now been converted into a small soft seed producer. So our next drought occurred here, and so this time the seed bank was full of not large seeds, but small soft seeds. Again, large numbers of birds died, but this time the selective advantage fell to the small birds with the small beaks. And the selection differentials, which had gone this way in the previous era, now went this way. So this told us that it was a preceding ecological condition that determined the direction of selection. So we went on, and the next really strong perturbation occurred in 2002 to 2005, when we had an unprecedented drought, which lasted 2.5 years. No rainfall fell, practically no rainfall fell in 2.5 years. And again, large numbers of birds died. This time, about 90% of the birds on the island died. But the reason was different this time. There was a large number of tribulus seeds. We went into the drought with a large number of tribulus seeds, just as we did in 1977. But in 1983, what had happened is that another bird had arrived on the island. This was a large ground finch. So it was this massive finch here. absolutely loved tribulus seeds. So it outcompeted the large porters for these tribulus seeds. Here's Magnanospis up here with this gigantic beak. So it outcompeted this large porters for the tribulus seeds and left the smaller porters, which managed to survive on the few small soft seeds, but they also changed their behavior. They became very interested, followed the Magnanospis around, and as the Magnanospis cracked the tribulus seeds, small seeds were flicked out from either side, and they were able to run and pick these up. So although 90% of the birds died, the few that were left were the smallest of the ground finches. So we were down here this time, and they have remained small ever since. So the question is, with all this, with these extreme droughts, where the populations drop about 80 to 90% each time, we can ask, how is the genetic variation maintained to keep the population going? And the answer is rare genetic exchange, which I'll tell you about now. So these two birds, Portus and Scandens, we could ask, first of all, what is the barrier to reproduction between these two species? And the answer is song and morphology, because in every other respect, the birds are very similar. Very similar in plumage, males are black, females are brown. They all nest, build these dome nests, and as far as we can tell, they are very similar in courtship behavior. But they do differ in song and morphology. Song turns out is very important. Porter sings these songs which are the modulated songs, which to us sound, we sometimes call them the Swiss bird, because it sounds like mostly. And Scandian, the cactus finch, always sings these repeated notes, cha-cha-cha-cha-cha-cha. The individuals only sing one short song, they have a repertoire of one. But there is individual variation, but always on a species-specific song theme. So this is a variation of the tortoise song and a variation of the Scandian song, where the interval between the notes are a little bit shorter. Now we also know from work done by Bowman that song is learned. He did this work in the 1950s when he were able to take birds away from the Galapagos Islands, and he took all species of darkness finches back to San Francisco. He reared them in captivity, and because you can't do this today, he reared them in captivity, and he did a number of experiments on them, and he showed that song is learned in association with morphology during a very short sensitive period, early in life, between day 10 and day 40. And this period coincides with the last few days when the birds are in the nest, and when they're out of the nest, being fed by their parents. So it is not too surprising that the individuals learn almost perfect renderings of their father's song. Females do not sing, but all the time that the birds, in the last few days when they're in the nest and when they're out of the nest being fed by the parents, and the father is singing. And once they learn the song is retained absolutely unaltered for life, and life can be as long as 17 years. So as adults, they mate according to their species-specific song, learn in association with the morphology early in life. So this constitutes a pre-mating barrier to interbreeding, which is based on learning. So we can ask, how robust is this barrier? Does it ever leak? Because after all, it is vulnerable to disruption. If a young bird hears and learns a song of another species during this very sensitive period, and this does happen. It happens when the Scandians, which is a little bit bigger, takes over a porpoise nest. Normally it turns out all the eggs, but occasionally an egg is left behind, and the young grow up learning their foster father's song. Now, the colonization which I told you about, Magnolosphorus, which happens to be the closest relative to porpoise, gave us the opportunity to test the barrier to interbreeding. Magnolosphorus is almost twice the size of porpoise, at 32 grams. And we had, over the time, eight porpoise and two Scandians that learned a Magnolosphorus song. But none of them bred the Magnolosphorus. So, because what happened was every time these pulling birds opened their mouths and sang a Magnolosphorus song, a Magnolosphorus whooped with it as if from nowhere and just beat the living daylights out. So they didn't live to breed. But so it seems that when the size difference is very large, this barrier is robust. Even learning a Magnolosphorus song did not lead to mating. However, the situation was very different between porpoise and Scandians, where the size difference is much less. Porpoise is 18 gram bird, Scandians are 22 gram bird. And here, learning another species song does lead to, or can lead to, hybridization. Now this happens very rarely, only about 1 to 2% of every breeding episode. So we can first ask, these two birds, although they belong to the same genera, they're not the most closely related species. So we wondered at first if there was any genetic incompatibility between them. And we thought that there could be, because in the first 10 years of our study, none of the hybrids survived the first breeding season, the first dry season to breed. And so we thought this may be due to genetic incompatibility, but also these birds with intermediate beak sizes may not have been able to eat the large hard seeds which were predominant in the environment at this time. And this seems to be correct, because when, after the 1983 El Nino, which completely transformed the island, then these hybrids began to survive. they did not breed with each other, probably because there were very few of them, but they did breed that cross according to one or other of the parental species, according to the song type that they learned from their father. So what happened then was that after 1983, when the hybrids began to survive, we got the two populations, Fortis and Sudanians, which previously been so separated here, began to converge morphologically. And this convergence continued up to the present day. They also converged genetically, and at this time, we were using microsatellite loci. We had 16 microsatellite loci, but we were able to track these microsatellite loci and show how they moved from Portus to Scandians and Scandians to Portus. So using the microsatellite loci, we saw that there was genetic convergence, and then putting our morphological measurements on top of this, we saw that the morphological measurements almost exactly parallel genetic measurements, as you would expect, of course. Now, in the sixth, then, we have collaborated with, since then, we have collaborated with somebody that you will probably know, because he spends at least 3 months at Texas A&M, and that is Lady Anderson. So I think some of you may have heard him talk about this just a month ago. But one of the things that I didn't show you was that in one of our selection events, there was a huge change in beak shape in porpoise. The porpoise became much more pointed, and then it remained pointed thereafter. Now, with Leif Anderson and his group from Sweden, we have collaborated with him. They have done all the genetic work, and they have sequenced all the Darwin Spinner species. And in doing this, they found, to us, which is extremely exciting, they have found an ARX1 gene that encodes a transcription factor, so a regulatory factor, that affects beak pointedness. So knowing that we got this, and here's Leif Anderson here, and the person, his PhD student, Sangeet, who did most of the work, is right here. So, knowing that they found this ALX1 gene, we then went back to this point where we had seen this extreme shift in beak shape, and we went back into our blood samples, we kept the freezer at Princeton, and we dug out both the blood samples for some hybrids at this point and for some pure porpoise that we had taken at this point. Because we wanted to know if the ALX1 pointed haplotype, I should say this ALX1 gene occurs in two variants. One is a pointed variant, one is a blunt variant. The pointed variant occurs in most of the species in Darwin's pictures. The blunt variant occurs wholly in the Magnerostris that I showed you with this big blunt beak. But in porpoise, there's both the blunt variant and the pointed variant. So we wanted to know if the pointed variant actually contributed to the genetic variation in porpoise on which selection could act. So what we found out from the blood from our eight hybrids, the Portus Scandens hybrids, we had 6 of them from Portus and Scandens, and we had 2 from Caliginosa, which is a small ground fish, which I hadn't mentioned before. It occasionally comes to the island, and when it does, it usually sometimes hybridizes with Portus. So both these are pointed. And we found that the ALX1 pointed haplotype had a frequency of 0.75 in the hybrid and 0.44 in the porpoise non-hybrid, which is in the direction we would expect if the ALX1 pointed hybrid haplotype was going from Scandens to porpoise and Caliginosa into porpoise. So it seems that the ALX1 pointed haplotype introduced by gene probes most probably contributed to the point of geeks in Porters. And this continual hybridization which we have heard, and backcrossing which we saw after this, was probably contributed to by this AX1 point of haplotype. So this was very exciting to actually see one gene moving across like this, and not just the microsatellite loci that we had seen before. And the effect was this, with the in Porters, where the blunt haplotype corresponded with the blunt geeks, the pointed homozygous pointed ones, the pointed geeks, and the heterozygous for the intermediate geek shape. So the gene flow goes in both directions. We got a change in shape. The average geek shape of Porter population became more pointed, as I've just shown you, and the average geek shape of Scandinavians became blunter. I showed you this before, where the actual geek depth has not changed, but look at the flip. This has become much blunter than it was when it first started, and very much more Porter-like. And because of the change of genes between the exchange of genes between Porters and Scandinavians, as we would expect, the coefficient of variation, both in genetic variation and the morphological variation, increased in both. And I don't even have to give you those. You could just see this from the pictures themselves. All these photographs were taken in 2012. They're all Scandinavians. This Scandinavian with a large pointed beak looked very much like the 1980. The Scandinavians before 1983 and before genetic exchange, whereas other Scandinavians look much more focus-like due to much blunter geek. So we can argue that this episodic genetic exchange increases morphological and genetic variation on which selection can act. And in a changing or new environment, this can be a very rapid route to change. And this, in the formation of the union in chimpanzees, is a very exciting example of exactly how this happened. And so it happened this way. In 1981, a bird arrived on the island at the time when a student, Trevor Price, was on the island, and he had almost all the birds landed on the island. This bird arrived, it looked like a porter. It was huge, it was 28 grams, whereas a porter is usually 18 grams. And he felt sure it hadn't been born on the island. He couldn't have missed something like this. So Peter and I came back, and later we re-caught the bird. Trevor had abandoned it 5110. We re-caught the bird, and this time we took a small drop of blood for genetic analysis. And we found Trevor was exactly right. We matched up the genetic profile with other birds on Daphne. It could not have been born on Daphne. But we matched it up, we've been to other islands, and we matched it up with birds from all other islands, and particularly islands round about. We found that it must have come from Santa Cruz, but it wasn't a Porters from Santa Cruz, it was a Porters Scandinavians Porters backcross from Santa Cruz, shown by 95% probability from an assignment test. Also, to our delight, it had a genetic marker. It was homozygous for an extremely rare allele at one of our microsatellite loci, the allele 183. And then when it started to breed, it had a unique song, a song never heard before on Daphne, and actually never heard before on Santa Cruz either. When it took ages to breed, but when it did breed, it bred with a Porter Scandinavians Porter backcross born on Daphne. And then it bred with two other Porters. And that was the only outcrossing that ever happened. It produced a large number of offspring. All the birds had at least one copy of this unique allele, and all the males sang this 5110 song. And then this 2.5 year drought hit us. All these birds died except for two. These two. A male and a female that were a brother and a sister. They, after the drought, they bred with each other. They produced 26 offspring, all but 9 survived and bred. There was a daughter breeding with her father, a son with her mother, and has since bred with each other to produce more offspring. larger. And this is a young one up here, so don't pay too much attention to the yellow bill. That's just showing it's a young one. And, but they're much larger than Portus, the nearest relative. They're in morphological space, they occur here. And this is 99% ellipses. They lie in the gap between Magdalostris and Portus. And this was a gap that expanded when Magdalostris outcompeted the large Portus. And the big birds just moved neatly into here. They sing a different song. They have three generations of this song, very different from Portus and Spaniards and Magdalostris songs. They hold territories that are contiguous with each other. They defend these territories against each other. The blue dots are territories before the drought, the red dots after the drought, and there are a couple just over the cliff there. And these territories overlap with the territories of Portus, Scandens, and Magdalostris, who they completely ignore and who are ignored by them. So in all respects, the lineage is functioning as a separate species. Will it die out to when we need depression? Well, it might, but there's no sign so far. Will the genetic variation be augmented through gene exchange? Well, it might, but there's no sign so far. So whether it survives or not, this new lineage gives us insight into how a new species could arise and either persist or become extinct. So this is how we started. The whole the environment changed after 1983. Portus and Scandens began to converge. Magdalostris outcompeted. It arrived on the island of 1983, built up to several hundred individuals, outcompeted the larger Portus. The big bird lineage moved into here. So given the origin of the new big bird lineage through interspecies gene flow, we can ask, is there any evidence of genetic exchange between species at earlier stages in the adaptive radiation? And most importantly, could genetic exchange have contributed to the formation of new phenotypes and the development of new species in the crops? So what we did is to test for this, we used the test that was devised by Green. So these statistics were tested for the genetic stage between Neanderthals and early homoceptors. And the idea is that the test is based on the prediction that the derived alleles should occur with equal frequency in the two taxa. So what they did is they took the SAM populations, present-day SAM populations, as an example of Asian populations, the French one as an example of the European one, and they argued that if any mutation occurred here, it should occur in equal frequency in these two groups. And as the ancestral one, it took as Neanderthals, and the outer groups of chimps. And they argued that the two SNP patterns, they had half a million, roughly half a million SNPs, and they argued that the two SNP patterns, ABBA and BABA, should be equally frequent if there was no gene flow. So what they found was that 60% of the SNPs confirmed the phylogeny, but they also found that that there was an excess of the ABBA over the BABA pattern, which showed that there was gene flow between the French and the Neanderthal populations. Now this assumption is that the ancestral populations were randomly mating and that there was no ancestral subdivision, which could have affected this. But we use this same test because with our, or with Leif Anderson, we've done all of these genetic sequences, then that's the likelihood phylogenetic tree based on also genome sequences showed a huge anomaly. One was that the sharp deep ground pinchers on three islands, Penedina, Santiago, and Pinta, were more closely related to tree pinchers, whereas the sharp deep ground pinch to Basilis on the far islands of Darwin and Wolf, which look very similar to these, were more similar to the ground pinchers. They wondered what on earth was going on. There's an ABBA rabbit test. We had actually quite a number of SNPs, we had over a million SNPs, and 39% of them confirmed the phylogeny, but we saw this excess pattern of ABBA relate some of the phenotypic similarities that we were seeing. We repeated this, which I won't go through all the repetition that we did, but in summary, we found that there was extensive interspecific gene flow throughout the whole radiation. And knowing that genetic exchange played a key role in the formation of the Big Bird lineage in contemporary times, we think that genetic exchange most probably contributed to the formation of new phenotypes and the development of human species in the past. Now, this is something that was probably thought to have happened in plants, but up until 15 years ago, people who had only tried to publish data on introgression, we were told that introgression does not happen in animals. Now, there was one exception to this, and this was Lewington, who did some work on insects, where he showed that in the Dacus, Lewington birch and the Dacus fruit fly in Australia, he showed that introgression between two Dacus fruit flies produced a third species which is able to live in much higher temperatures than either of the two ancestral Dacus. Apart from that, it wasn't considered a poor possibility. But since then, we've had examples in practically all organisms. And it has become much more popular to see this. And of course, there's been hybridization and introgression, which Stanley Powell's group has shown between Neanderthals and Denisovans and the modern human lineages. And they've also been able to show that certain very important genes have been passed from Neanderthals into humans, particularly those genes associated with the immune system. And they suggested that this has restored the HLA diversity and also they acquired new HLA variants that were better able to adapt to local pathogens. Just as we have shown that the haplotype that was associated with deep pointedness played such a large role in the Darwin's finches. And they also showed genes that were associated with keratin, skin, and depth. So Darwin, this famous diagram that Darwin had in his notebook, where he first of all tried to think of the phylogenetic relationships or the species relationships, and he scribbled this little pattern in his notebook, and he wrote, I think, well, would he now join up some of these and write, I now realize, well, we don't know. But populations track extreme environments through evolutionary responses to natural selection events, shown there. We show that rare genetic exchange between populations increases the genetic and morphological variation on which selection can act. And in a changing or new environment, this allows rapid adaptation along a different trajectory to form unique phenotypic lineages. And this can be very important in the formation of new species. So the message is thus to maintain genetic variability and potential for rapid exchange in natural areas. Natural areas must be kept intact with their full complement of species. So I think this is an extremely important lesson that has come out of this work. So how do we do this? Well, by keeping natural areas intact and sustainably harvesting them, we can preserve the genetic variability and the potential for further natural change of its flora and fauna. So it has been calculated that by sustainably harvesting an intact area of forest, and this again was calculated from Ecuador, an average hectare could produce approximately, at this time, $6,800 worth of commercially valuable goods per year, year after year, compared with $1,000 per hectare for one kind of clear-cutting commercial timber, or $148 if used once as cattle pasture. Now, several groups in Ecuador, as well as the Global Rainforest Action Network, are assisting local communities by giving them ownership and management of their land for ecotourism and for sustainable harvesting of goods. And also, there's also been, and I think this is again extremely important, that when you have a problem, you shouldn't just tackle it one way, but you should tackle tackle it from several directions at once. And the person that I had probably greatest admiration for along these lines in Ecuador is this man called Giannavi Amori. He's a Jesuit priest who is also a biologist. He managed to get a large amount, was continuing to get a large amount of funding from Italy. He's Italian. And what he has done is he has bought cloud forest, actually, the cloud forest area, and he has given this ownership to the local community. But he said that this is not good enough. He has also built schools with this money. He's put the best teachers he can find into these schools. He's also built a hospital clinic in that area. And since this has started, he started this about 20 years ago, so the young children in this school are now grown up, and they have become doctors, and they have become lawyers, and they have all, as a community, the lawyers have been interested in actually maintaining this large piece of land, and they all, as a community, are preserving this land for sustainable development. So just one small piece, he is adding to it each year as he gets more and more money, so the area is growing. But it's a little area, and if only we could expand this, then I think we should be in a... It's one little ray of hope, which I hope we will be able to expand. So we thank many of many graduates, our postdoc fellows, our collaborators, and particularly Leigh Anderson and his group most recently, our daughters who have also been very much involved in all this, and then Galapagos National Park, Charles Darwin Research Station, and our funding agencies. But I'd like to leave you with the one message which I hope has come out of my talk, in that environment and populations are dynamic. They're constantly changing, and we should realize that they're constantly changing. And for a healthy environment, we must keep them both capable of further natural change.